If you're anything like me, then you've always been told that the best way to grow your wealth is to get into property. And that's probably true, but I'm not skilled enough to do it and probably way too lazy. So the next best thing is real estate investment trusts. Welcome back everyone, my name's Paul. My entire life I've always been told that investing in any form has been completely out of my reach. I'm either not rich enough or it's just too complicated for me and I should forget it. But now I'm in my early-ish, maybe mid-30s, some doors have been opened to me and I've realized it's not that fucking hard. Many people choose different ways to invest. The easiest possible is to get into index funds and just smash your money in every month, dollar cost average, all that sort of thing. But there are also different strategies in growth and dividend investing, value investing. And if you're looking into these single equities, then you're going to have to do just a little bit more work. And today, just because a lot of people have been asking, I want to talk about real estate investment trusts, or REITs. I used to call them REITs. I think I agree, REITs is much, much better. Now this is a tricky one because I don't exactly know where to start. As far as complicated investing goes, real estate investment trusts is probably one of the hardest ones to understand. It's not that hard though, and you can invest into them, but you might have to be a bit more clued up on it. Real estate investment trusts focus on one thing, property. But that's a bit misleading because there are literally hundreds of different types of real estate investment trusts. You can have ones that just invest in mortgages or shopping centers or gyms. I think there's even one for golf courses. So more than anything with REITs, it's best to understand the sector that you're going into and any possible headwinds. You want to be looking at the qualities of the company and its sector really above anything else. But let's start at the basics. As a dividend investor, I'm invested in a lot of REITs, many of the famous ones really, like Digital Realty Trust, Realty Income, Tritax Big Box, Segro, and I've recently bought into this one called Avalon Bay Communities. And as it's a new holding, I'll take you through Avalon Bay as an example of how I would evaluate a REIT. When a company becomes a real estate investment trust, it basically becomes a massive tax haven and a massive dividend payer. There's a few things that a REIT needs to do to become a real estate investment trust, but in relation to us right now, all you really need to know is that REITs have to pay out 90% of their taxable income as dividends. That's the main way you're going to make money on a real estate investment trust. And I checked, it's almost exactly the same in the US as it's in the UK, so there's no worries there either. So usually REITs will specialize in a certain area. They'll buy properties that link to a certain industry. For example, Digital Realty Trust is doing really well at the moment because it's invested in data centers. So they're basically one of the cloud and computing versions of real estate investment trusts. You've got the most popular one, which is Realty Income, which is heavily diversified across lots of different industries. I have Segro and Tritax, which are two UK big box REITs. They're basically providing all of Amazon's warehouses in Europe. And I've got one like Store Capital, which is focused much more on the service industry. It basically builds buildings around anything that Amazon can't get its hands on. So anything that you have to physically go to and you can't order off the internet. Cinemas are counted in that, and that's quite a risk at the moment. So you need to realize how complex REITs can actually be. And my latest one, which is Avalon Bay, is an apartment REIT. Let's take a look at it. So we can scroll down to the company details and we find out the company is focused on development, real development, acquisition, ownership of multifamily communities, primarily in New England, New York, and New Jersey. Okay, I don't know why I'm even going into this because all of this is fucking useless. Unfortunately, the tools in Trading 212 do not cover REITs pretty much in any way. In some cases, like the balance sheet and maybe some of the cash flow is okay. For instance, off the top of my head, I do know that Avalon Bay has $19 billion in assets and $8 billion in total liabilities. So that is correct and a positive. It's got double the amount in assets than it does in liabilities. That's the first good sign, right? But any of these ratios that you see right here are totally incorrect. So unfortunately, we do have to head out of Trading 212 to assess REITs. So let's start from the start and figure out exactly what Avalon Bay does. So Avalon Bay builds, redevelops, and creates these little communities of apartments that it rents out to pretty much middle to high class earners, to be honest. All of its apartments are pretty luxury and in high income areas. And they focus on these mixed use development communities. And by that, they mean they don't just build the apartments and let people live in them. On the bottom floor, they'll often have a gym, a pet area, a bar, something like that, all to bring in this community experience. So in a nutshell, that's what it is. It builds apartments that are pretty luxury, that offer you a bit more to your life than just being an apartment. So let's figure out the quantitative part of the business. And by that, I mean, let's look at the numbers. As I've already said, trading 212 is pretty fucking useless for this. And to figure out why, you need to understand depreciation. So if you're a normal business, you'll calculate the amount of income you earn by taking the amount of sales that you made and minus how much it cost you to make those sales. In that cost, there will be a thing called depreciation. So depreciation focuses on assets that a company buys. So in a normal company, they could buy a truck, a lovely truck that we've got there. Sorry, it's probably pointed in the wrong direction there. Should probably point like that, maybe. I'll draw in a little guy, some CEO that might be catching it at the bottom of the hill there. But when a company buys something like a truck, over the years, it will lose value. Like how they say your car loses half of its value as soon as it leaves the forecourt. And companies suffer from this just as much as we do. A company will write down that truck as depreciation. It'll take some value off it, and they will put that down as an expense, reducing their overall income. However, REITs invest in buildings, and buildings generally appreciate. In fact, they pretty much never depreciate, and the taxman knows this. So when it comes to the net income that the REIT makes, the actual building will appreciate in value and therefore raise the amount of income. It really throws out the calculations and it makes REITs really hard to value. So instead of the normal PE ratios and payout ratios that we would understand with normal companies, REITs are more accurately valued by funds from operations and adjusted funds from operations. These are at their truest form, the income statement without the appreciation. Adjusted funds from operations are the same as FFO, but they add on a little bit of maintenance and ground rent, that sort of thing. Where most companies simply just rent their buildings off REITs, REITs have to maintain and clean these buildings. So they have to add that little bit of extra cost to just make it that bit more accurate. And when I say it's accurate, it's not that accurate. They literally just put any number they want on it. So you do have to go with it a bit because there's no actual industry standard for it. And I can give you a great visual representation of the difference that this makes. This is FastGraphs. FastGraphs is a new thing that I've bought a subscription to just to make life easier. A lot for just putting this to camera, actually. But if we look at it based on income statement, everything is like all over the place. However, when we change things to adjusted funds for operations, things look a bit more normal. So this white line at the bottom is the payout ratio. That basically shows the level of dividend that they're giving. The orange line with the shaded green is how much cash they have flowing through the business. And the first thing I would notice for this is that white line is very close to the orange line. That means that the amount of cash that's going through the business is very close to the amount of dividend that they're paying out. Not great in a normal company, but we have to remember that REITs give out 90% of their income as dividends. They have to, it's the law. So you would expect these lines to be pretty close. And in fact, a 75% AFO payout ratio for a REIT is pretty good. Now I know that FastGraphs is a paid for service that you might not have access to, but there is a free site called REIT Notes, which is pretty exceptional, to be honest. It's pretty good. You can see the price change here, and then it shows you the dividend payments by year. And as you can see that every quarter it stays flat, but every year it goes up and it goes up by a reasonable amount. Next, you get to see the funds from operations payout ratio, which you can see is around 60 to 75%, which is a pretty good payout ratio for this type of REIT. And actually, REIT Notes gives you really accurate and great information on all REITs, really. This one I have checked with their own website, I promise, but it tells you that they've got 288 properties, all of the same type, in 12 different states, all in the USA. A very important metric to look at with REITs is its occupancy rate. Anything below 90% is really a no-go for me. Just my personal opinion. With REITs, I want to be going for quality. I don't want to be going for some cowboy organization. And we can see that Avalon Bay is well above 90 there. I think it was 94.7, something like that. And then we want to look at the balance sheet, and I'll prove to you here that trading 212 was definitely right with 19 billion in assets and 8 billion in total liabilities there. So trading 212 does have some accurate stuff as far as REITs go. It's just you can't rely on its ratios at all. But what we do want to see is clearly that divide between the total assets and total liabilities. REITs often have a large amount of debt because they're always buying and selling properties. So debt really isn't an issue for REITs, unless its ability to pay off that debt is becoming a real problem. But in Avalon Bay's case, it doesn't have that problem at all. Quarterly revenues have been decreasing. I don't like to look at quarterlies. I'm not going to take any note of quarterly revenues right now because it's a bit of an iffy time, isn't it? But year on year, I do know that revenues are always increasing. But with REIT notes, I have found it really good and really accurate. And they even give you this nice scorecard at the end. It's a really good service and I can't believe that it's free. It gives you all these scores and it rates it against the industrial average, which, as you can see, Avalon Bay scores really highly on most cases. But we can have a look where it does fall down and figure out what the problems are. So it scores a 7 on its adjusted funds in comparison to its revenues. And this is expected from Avalon Bay because it runs luxury apartments. And if we remember, the adjusted funds from operations is all about maintenance and cleanliness, things like that. And with them having all these luxury complexes, I expect them to have lots of maintenance costs, lots of security costs, things like that, because they want the best. They're going to get the highest quality. It scores a 7 on its revenue growth. Admittedly, it hasn't had the best revenue growth. It is way above industry average. But there is something about rental apartments that hasn't been bringing in money recently. And down here, we get a 2 for market cap strength. That's because during this recession, it has fallen dramatically, like everything else. And REIT notes give it an overall score of 8.6. On the site, I don't see too many which are above that, to be honest. I do think 10's the highest, but I don't think anything really scores over a 9.2, 9.6 sort of thing. And it gives you a nice comparison down here of all of the similar REITs and how it scores against them. There's plenty out there to look at, guys. It's not just this one. This is just how I'm looking at Avalon Bay as a stock. You can apply this process to any REIT and come out with your own decision on which one you wish to buy. If any, to be honest. We'll talk about that later. Okay, so that's the free version. There's lots of details in there to look at. It's great. But for the sake of recording, FastGraphs is probably going to be the best thing I can show you. We'll have a look at past performance against the S&P 500. Avalon Bay has outperformed the S&P 500 both on actual growth and by far on dividend growth as well. 20 years is a long time and it's done really well. And I'll show you just for even that in the past 3 years, it's actually down 27%. This is because Avalon Bay hasn't recovered from the crash yet. And I don't think it should be news to anyone that the S&P 500 has recovered really well. And this is why I'm looking at Avalon Bay. I'm trying to figure out why it hasn't recovered yet. For this part, you have to remember that I'm looking at solely fundamentals and nothing else. And judging by the past, Avalon Bay has stuck to its normal PE ratio for the past 15 years. But when there are signs of a market downturn, like in 2008, people sell out of Avalon Bay so hard. And then it completely recovers, all while keeping its dividend well intact. And we might have something similar happening right here. The world's got a bit scared, the price has sold off massively, we're still scared about some economic problems, but the price is still way below its cash flow. In fact, if everything goes well, and we only see this small dip in revenue, then we could have a 21% upside. There's nothing to say this won't get tougher though. I'm making this video probably a few days before its next earnings report on 28th of October. That earnings report is likely to say everything's still going well, maybe even going better than expected. But after that, Avalon Bay might run into some trouble. And that's where we have to look at the quality data. And like any company you're about to invest in, you should be looking through their presentations. And I looked through Avalon Bay's specifically to find what they consider their risks to be. And you can look through any investor presentation and you should be able to find a section where the company outlines what it considers to be its greatest risks. And this is what Avalon Bay thinks. Corporate restructurings and or layoffs, industry slowdowns and other factors that adversely affect the local economy. A decline in household formation or employment or lack of employment growth, the inability or unwillingness of residents to pay rent increases, rent control or rent stabilization laws, or economic conditions that could increase our operating expenses, such as increased property taxes, utilities, or compensation of on-site associates and routine maintenance. Do we think that any of that applies right now? Your answer should be yes. In fact, all of that applies right now to the US economy at the moment. So I have to figure out how badly this is going to affect Avalon Bay. And looking through their recent quarters, they've been pretty resilient. They're still maintaining their 94.6 occupancy rate. And through the months of July and August, they've managed to maintain 96% of their rental income. That's pretty good so far. Things are keeping up to this point. But we've had a lot of stimulus going into the US economy, so is that the thing that has been keeping the rent going? The US appears to be on the edge of an eviction crisis. Throughout the furlough scheme in the US, the UK and Europe, no landlords have been allowed to evict their tenants. That's regardless of whether they could pay rent or not. And the eviction ban is coming to an end towards the end of the year. And anyone who's invested in real estate, particularly in housing and apartments, is really scared of this eviction thing. If you're going to get into an apartment REIT at the moment, you need to be prepared for this risk. But I'm willing to take the risk on Avalon Bay because they're a different type of an apartment REIT. First of all, Avalon's communities are dotted around the entire US, all in high income areas, all in places where their customers or their tenants aren't likely to have lost their job. Their apartments have a lot of features that make them really appealing to the young middle class. And the apartments are pretty good, all in the city centre, next to big businesses, all in dense urban areas, gyms and everything like that. Even this one's got a fucking dog wash. Look at this. Dogs living a better life than me. Fuck. So as an apartment REIT in itself, I'm not 100% convinced that Avalon Bay is going to be really hit hard by this pandemic. And I quite strongly hold the belief that this drop in price and the reason why it hasn't recovered isn't to do with any proper news out there or any solid evidence that the business is going under. It's actually because everyone's so uncertain about what's going to happen. However, with Avalon Bay, we've got a great payout ratio, great revenues, low interest rates. There's no reason to believe that it should do any worse than normal. I looked at this graph as well, which shows home ownership rate for the United States, and it's very cyclical. We are coming out of a boom of renters, so this could be a risk to Avalon Bay. Maybe people at the moment are looking into getting mortgages and buying their own property in the US. However, it's become very hard in the US and the UK to actually get a mortgage. So it may be that there are some more customers in the near future that are going to drive up demand. Another positive is that Timothy Norton has been buying in right at the lows, and lots of other insiders have been buying into Avalon Bay. And what's more, Avalon Bay doesn't usually do a share buyback program, but I found out that they raised $500 million to start buying back their own stock. So if anything, the share price should start to benefit from that pretty soon. This is a double-edged sword though, because they have sold some assets to do this. I still can't work out if that's a good thing or a bad thing. I think that one is just down to opinion. And finally, working from home was another positive point that I liked. I thought of it as really important that these apartment blocks should start to incorporate working from home. And it seems that apartment REITs haven't really caught on to that yet. And then I saw this interview with CEO Timothy Norton and his head of design, and they kind of answered the question for me.
It's a little bit early to be talking about this, I think, but nevertheless, thinking forward a little bit, do you anticipate any design or layout changes coming, you know, in the post-COVID world, more work from home space, maybe change in configuration of delivery packages, you know, receiving areas, anything like that?
Yeah, no, it's a good question, Scott. I mean, probably, but I think a lot of those were already happening or starting to happen. I think they'll accelerate as a result of this. If you just look at sort of the changing nature of work, a gig economy, people working 24/7, the work from home trend was already gaining traction before the pandemic. It's on steroids now, but we were already starting to, you know, either in new development or redevelopment, put in co-working spaces, and and just creating, trying to create a, you know, work environment in terms of whether it's connectivity. I think you'll see a lot more investment in smart home technology, which I think kind of starts with really kind of smart locks and really about remote access. So you can sort of, if you're working from home, just have sort of frictionless movement of goods and services, you know, coming in out of your apartment or your community. I think these co-working centers are going to have a mix of, you know, private spaces and open spaces. They're going to need, meeting spaces with equipment like what we're on right now that can really accommodate, you know, virtual conferencing, meetings, you know, great connectivity. It's going to need to be community-wide, not just within your apartment. So you can move in, you can move from your apartment all the way through the community into the outdoor, even the outdoor spaces, and you know, never lose a connection, which is tough to do today. So I think the work from home movement is definitely a trend that continues. You know, if anything, I think companies are going to be certainly much more receptive to it coming out of the pandemic, you know, letting, whether folks are working full time or, you know, part time outside the office.
That was quite a convincing interview for me. It was about an hour long. It showed me that those guys really know what they're talking about. And that little clip there shows that they're trying to design in new ways of working, this frictionless movement, and lots of data coming into these apartments, allowing people just to be a lot more comfortable at home while working. And I thought that was a nice touch. By the way, 203 views since 25th of September. Why don't these CEO interviews get more attention? People put so much money into these stocks and no one pays attention. I don't get it. So Avalon Bay is one of my new companies, which I'm basing around the dividend investment strategy. I see quite good growth in the future. I see its dividend doing really well. And in the long term, I think it's going to be a really good property company. However, it does come with risks, and it comes with a lot of risks associated with this pandemic. So it might not necessarily be one for everyone to invest in. So that is my take on REITs. If I've missed anything out, please let me know, because I am still relatively new to this myself. So I do realize that there must be stuff out there that I just don't know, and I'm always willing to learn. Thank you very much for watching, guys. The investment app that I use is called Trading212. If you wanted to get into investing, you can use a link in the description below. If you sign up through that link, you get a free share and I get a free share too. Feel free to leave a comment below with any REITs that you found interesting. I'm always looking for new stocks I can get into. And if you wanted to continue the chat, you can on the Discord. It's free to get into. There's a link in the description below as well. Thank you very much for watching, guys. And if you found this video interesting, please feel free to like, subscribe, and invest.